Good morning, everyone. It's, beautiful to see this Beit Midrash full. It only works when it's full. And I hope that we ran you ragged late last night so that you were able to get a good night's sleep, get through your jet lag, and show up bright and early ready to learn this morning. I want to talk today about the encounter between the individual who is seeking righteousness and a society or a situation that lacks righteousness, and to ask what paradigms or precedents we can draw from our tradition to understand why and how this encounter between the individual and society is supposed to take place. And part of the reason I want to do this is because oftentimes our conversations about justice and righteousness take the form of the conversation that we had here in the courtyard last night, which is merely looking at a society identifying its problems or what it's lacking in terms of a culture of justice and righteousness and wondering how it's supposed to fix itself. We also sometimes talk about the terms of justice and righteousness as individual characteristics that are part of the larger philosophical quest of the individual to become a good person. But I'm interested actually in sitting at the nexus between those. What happens when an individual perceives a social or a societal ill, and such a person in a position of leadership, what are the characteristics that are meant to translate between the efforts of an individual seeking righteousness and a society that may actually lack or may be suffering from a absence of righteousness? Now, sometimes this encounter and the resulting pace of change between an individual and a society is incremental, and sometimes it's radical. Sometimes that pace, whether incremental change or radical change, has to do with the personality of the moral actor, and sometimes it has to do with the urgency of the issue or the problem that's being dealt with. We all know instances that we could think of and we could talk about and complain about other people in which efforts towards social change fail, either because of lack of urgency, right? Pace of change, think incrementally, and therefore you look 20, 30 years after a problem has been identified and it hasn't gone away because of a lack of urgency. And we also know of situations in which the effort by an individual to change or transform a society also fails because of the overselling of a cause, the boy who cried wolf problem. Right, the insistence that everything is a catastrophe makes people skeptical about whether anything is a catastrophe. And certainly there's a piece to the process of an individual seeking to make change in a society that stems merely from the personality of the individuals involved. Now, it's not for today to talk about the question of effectiveness. Right? And I think maybe perhaps later in the week when we have the sessions on the righteous personality, we can talk a little bit about what makes for an effective effort to actually not just be a righteous personality as an individual who's seeking to be righteous, but what makes for an effective righteous personality of an individual seeking to make change. But what I want to try to do today is to understand this issue of the individual, the leader, seeking to create transformative change around a culture of justice and righteousness. I want to try to think about it conceptually and to try to understand how our Jewish tradition imagines what this act of the individual leader setting themselves against the society to change it should look like, both to be able to understand what this means from the perspective of our past tradition, but also to situate it in the context of what it means to look at these kinds of questions today. For the purposes of today's discussion, I want to call this act, standing against the absence of righteousness and seeking to promote righteousness, I want to call this moral courage. We can unpack some of this language perhaps later in the Q&A. It seems to me that moral courage, as a philosophical category, lies at the nexus of three important criteria. That is to say, if it doesn't satisfy these three criteria, it's not moral courage. The three critical variables I think that belong in this conversation are optimism, number one. If you don't believe that the act that you undertake can actually bring about social change, then it's merely complaining, right? Optimism, that is to say, the belief that tomorrow has the possibility of actually being better than today, which is another shorthand definition for messianism, is a critical definition, a critical element of when moral courage is exercised and in the possibility of it being effective. The second critical variable is risk. It's not really courageous if there's no skin in the game, there's no possibility of adverse consequences for the individual who's setting out to do something that they consider to be morally courageous. And the third critical variable, in addition to optimism and risk, is that you have to be committed and in relationship in a deep way to something outside of the self, right? To act, to seek out, to intervene on behalf of a problem that merely is about your own individual standing is not moral courage. It's actually just empowered self-interest. Moral courage only comes into the game when you're talking about doing something on behalf of other human beings, on behalf of society, or possibly on behalf of God. I know Daniel yesterday talked a little bit about Abraham and Sodom, the people of Sodom. And one of the questions that lies underneath the whole story of Abraham fighting against God in on behalf of the people of Sodom is whether Abraham is actually fighting on behalf of the other people or fighting on behalf of God's reputation. When Abraham says to God, "Hashofet kol ha'aretz lo yaseh mishpat," will the judge of the world not act justly? Partly what he's saying is an act of proving to God that God has to act differently to the people of Sodom because it's part of God's responsibility. But one also hears under the surface that Abraham's argument against God is, God, you can't be yourself if you act in this way. And so I'm not merely acting morally courageous in this moment on behalf of other human beings or on behalf of a society. I'm acting courageously in this moment because I think I'm acting on your behalf. I'm inviting you, God, to be the best God that you're supposed to be. So three critical elements of moral courage: optimism, risk, and the interest, the desire, I would say even the inseparable desire from the self, that the process in which the moral actor is entering in is transformative and corrective for others. And again, that could be other individuals, it could be for a society, or it could be for God. The thesis I want to offer today, and if you haven't been paying attention so far, pay attention for the next 30 seconds so that you know what I'm talking about. The thesis I want to offer today is as follows. Our tradition imagines, or at least I'm going to present, two templates within our tradition for how moral courage is exercised in leadership. One we want to call the prophetic, and the second which I want to call the rabbinic. I want to play through what do we mean when we talk about prophetic moral leadership, and what do we mean when we talk about rabbinic moral leadership. For reasons that have some roots, I think, in Jewish history and in the transition from the prophetic to the rabbinic, and actually a lot of roots in kind of Jewish anxiety about the prophets, I think that the rabbinic offers a critique of the prophetic and sees itself as its replacement. I want to walk through this story in our sources, looking first at what we mean when we talk about the prophetic as a form of moral courage and moral leadership, and then ask at the end, once we've gone through the rabbinic critique and what I think constitutes the rabbinic substitute for this form of moral courage or moral leadership, I want to ask how we see ourselves as the inheritors of both of these paradigms. As a shortcut to the end, I think there's an interesting phenomenon taking place in Jewish life today where the prophetic is being resurfaced, where the language of the prophetic is something that's actually very desirable by Jews and Jewish leaders. I think this is partially to do with the legacy of Abraham Joshua Heschel for liberal American Jews. And I have concerns about it. So I want to talk about that. Partly I want to put on the table today is a concern that in the longing for the prophetic over the rabbinic, we put ourselves in a category of moral courage and moral leadership that actually is fraught with consequences, both for individuals who want to see themselves as prophets, as well as for a Jewish society at large that really can't handle prophecy. That's what I want to try to play with today. So if you take out your sources, everybody got the sources? I think they're the blue moral courage. Okay, so I want to first look at what do we mean when we talk about the prophetic? And to do this, I want to look at five prophetic sources, four of which are ours, and one of which is less so ours. And the prophetic texts we're going to look at are from Isaiah, Micha, and Jeremiah. And I mean to use these not to the total exclusion of others, but because I think they these texts will help us to identify what I want to call maybe four or five key characteristics of the prophetic impulse towards moral courage and moral leadership. I think they're emblematic of larger phenomena that are taking place in the prophets. And then Jonah and Matthew, the Gospel of Matthew, which we'll look at, are two different satires, one from within the canonical Jewish tradition, one I think from outside the Jewish tradition, or at least I want to read them as satires of the prophets because they surface some of the exact concerns or characteristics that I want to identify as being critical to the prophetic move. So let's read together through Isaiah, a famous text that's actually now, it's part of the liturgy on fast days. This is Isaiah at really Isaiah's best. Thus said the Lord, observe what is right and do what is just. Right, that's like the whole topic for the week, summarized in Isaiah 56:1. Just be good, for soon my salvation will come and my deliverance will be revealed. So idea number one that's actually clear throughout the prophetic tradition is that the message is quite simple. There's an insistence by the prophets that the message about justice is righteousness is much more simple than people make it out to be. We'll see later on that part of the critique of the prophets is not just that the moral message of being a good person is quite simple, but that it's been overlaid with all sorts of ritual baggage and all sorts of behavior that I don't think the prophets want us to stop doing, but they want to prevent us from being distracted from the fundamental obligations of being a good and righteous person in the world. And they feel that all of this other stuff, like sacrifices, have accumulated themselves and have accumulated over that notion of simply being a good person and have gotten in the way. But the second key element that's actually in this first verse is not just that you should be a good person and you should be righteous, but that being good and being righteous is deeply connected to the imminence of God's presence on earth. See what I did there? The imminence, those are two different words, that one is about to come and that God's presence is about to be ambient. And so it'll become obvious that the difference between good and evil is going to become very clear in the world very quickly. And if you don't align yourself with being good and being righteous, you'll find yourselves on the wrong side of history. Happy is the person who does this, the person who holds fast to it, who keeps the Shabbat and does not profane it, and stays his hand from doing any evil. Let not the foreigner say, who has attached himself to the Lord will keep me apart from his people. And let not the eunuch say, I am a withered tree. For thus said the Lord, as for the eunuchs who keep my Shabbat, who have chosen what I desire and hold fast to my covenant, I will give them in my house and within my walls, Yad Vashem, a monument and a name better than sons or daughters. I will give them an everlasting name which shall not perish. The prophet is always willing to bring under the auspices of the relationship to God those who would be alienated by other human beings. Now, partly the reason the prophet always does this is that the prophet, by his very nature, is alien from other human beings. So the prophet is drawn to and keeps as part of his compelling image of what justice and righteousness consists of, a willingness to embrace any of those who will embrace the good. If you have been cast out from the society by being a foreigner, or if you are actually cast out from the society by being essentially sterile, the eunuch, right, who can't be part of the vertical continuity of the Jewish people because you have no children, I will give you something better than children. This too is going to become a key characteristic of the prophet that we'll look at later on, which is that the prophet is not merely alienated from other human beings in horizontal relationships, that is to say, he's a social outcast. The prophet is also disconnected from other human beings in that he is disconnected from the process of parents and children. The prophet, I want to argue, is actually a one-generation phenomenon. The prophet is not interested in creating continuity. The prophet is interested in creating immediate change. And so part of the reason why Isaiah says here that I will give you something better than children, which will be a monument and a name, is the trade-off. I'm not interested in whether you as an individual or even you as a society wind up having direct continuity, because continuity is in some ways the opposite of change, right? I'm much more interested in actually a radical rupture and a breakdown of that social order and the transformation of that social order. And if it means that I will choose the eunuch, even though my society won't continue, right? I will choose the eunuch for the improvement of my society over those who have continuity is part of the radical move of the prophets. As for the foreigners who attach themselves to the Lord to minister to him and to love the name of the Lord to be his servants, all who keep Shabbat and do not profane it and hold fast to my covenant, I will bring them to my sacred mount and let them rejoice in my house of prayer. Their burnt offerings and sacrifices shall be welcome in my altar, for my house shall be called a house of prayer for all peoples. Thus declared the Lord, who gathers the dispersed of Israel, I will gather still more to those already gathered. Oda kabetz alav l'nik batzav. The message of the prophet, in this case, and we'll see in other cases as well, is a direct moral clarity that is disinterested in the social boundaries between people, and only interested in obedience and loyalty to God. This is, we've here a couple of different elements of the key characteristics of the prophets. One is a visionary and messianic ideal of the possibility of good. The second is the clarity of the moral message. This is critical to any time we look at the prophets, the clarity of the moral message, which as we'll see in Jeremiah, leads to extraordinary frustration. Why don't you people understand how clear and obvious what it is to be a good human being in the world? The more actually though we know this, the more that people insist on the clarity of their moral messages, the less likely it is that they can be heard, and the more likely it is that they're going to be socially ostracized by the ones who are to whom they are claiming the clarity of their moral message. The prophet has a clear moral message. He is disinterested, as you see in Isaiah here, in horizontal relationships with the people to whom he would think himself intrinsically loyal. And he's in some ways also disinterested in the vertical relationships between parents and children. And as we'll see later on, the prophet is also frustrated at not being heard. If you look at Micha, prophet Micha on the second page, we hear echoes of the same notion of justice and righteousness, but we start to hear the accumulation of a key element of the prophetic, which is frustration. It ain't a prophet if he isn't annoyed. There's never been, I think, a happy prophet. A prophet who's convinced that everybody's doing what they're supposed to do, because if everybody's doing what they're supposed to do, the prophet actually has no function in the world. So our whole tradition of the prophetic is increasingly irritated people. And partly I think that's actually what we're going to see in Jonah. If we understand Jonah, I think, as a satire, which is meant to be, Jonah is essentially a cranky sociopath. Right, he's completely removed from social and civil society, I think because our tradition is kind of making him a perfect storm, no pun intended, of what a prophet is supposed to be. I really didn't intend that, I promise. Okay, the prophet Micha says as follows, "Hear what the Lord is saying. Come present my case before the mountains and let the hills hear you pleading." Micha's claim against the people is partly rooted in the notion that actually the natural world understands this better than you human beings. When you talk about a notion of moral clarity, partly the reason why Micha is calling on the hills and the mountains to testify in front of God's presence is to say, why do you people have such a hard time understanding what goodness and righteousness means? It's even obvious to the natural world. "Hear you mountains, the case of the Lord, you firm foundations of the earth. For the Lord has a case against his people, he has a suit against Israel." The whole world knows this, except for whom? The Jewish people. And now another key element of the prophet begins to surface that we didn't hear yet in Isaiah, but becomes very clear in Micha, which is rage. A key element of the prophetic tradition is rage. This is partly, and to skip ahead, why some of the language of righteous indignation is associated with not just an ancient, but the modern prophetic move. Right? You're not doing something right. You're doing something wrong if you're not angry. We need anger in order to catalyze moral social change. Here you start hearing his rage in verse 3. "My people, what wrong have I done you? What hardship have I caused you? Testify against me or answer me. If I've done something wrong to you, I want to hear it." But obviously we know this from conversations between parents and children. This is a rhetorical question. What have I ever done to you? In fact, I brought you up from the land of Egypt. I redeemed you from the house of bondage. I sent before you Moses, Aaron, and Miriam. My people, remember what Balak, interesting by the way, Moses, Aaron, and Miriam, putting together all three of them. Not sure why, it's an interesting moment. "My people, remember what Balak, king of Moab, plotted against you and how Bilam, son of Beor, responded to him. Recall your passage from Shittim to Gilgal and you'll recognize the gracious acts of the Lord." Now, first the prophet called upon the mountains and the hills, that is the natural order, who can obviously understand what the Israelites are supposed to be doing and what they're failing to do. The second piece of evidence that the prophet adduces is it's not merely the natural order that understands this and you don't. It's the non-Jews who understand this and you don't. Right? Citing the case of Bilam and Balak is very telling because the claim that the prophet is essentially making is this is obvious to everybody except for you. They see it, the natural world sees it, and it's only you Israelites who are failing to understand the prophetic impulse. With what shall I, and here I think, here he is mocking the people. Right, this is another characteristic of the antisocial elements of the prophet. "With what shall I approach the Lord? Do homage to God on high. Shall I approach him with burnt offerings, with calves a year old?" And now the rhetorical response that Micha offers in response to this rhetorical question is, would the Lord really be pleased with the thousands of rams, with myriads of streams of oil? Shall I give my firstborn for my transgression, the fruit of my body for my sins? You hear the internal dialogue, right, that Micha is presenting between the people saying, should I just do these ritual acts to satisfy God, as though what God really wants is a kind of animalistic relationship, that God can be bought off with our animals or our firstborn children? And then finally in verse 8, you get once again the reiteration of the fundamental moral clarity that the prophet is insistent, that is completely obvious to everyone in the world except for the Israelites who are failing to listen, completely obvious to everyone except the society in which the prophet is located. Remember, the prophet sits paradoxically as a member of a society in which he cannot be a member. Right? He is insistent that everything around him is collapsing for failure of its moral leadership, and so he's part of that society. It doesn't work if you're not part of a society. You can't be a prophet if you're a complete outsider. And at the same time, his insistence on the direct moral clarity of his position constantly pushes him outside of the society that he's seeking to transform. And so here he says, he has told you, O man, what is good and what the Lord requires of you, only, just, do justice and love goodness and walk modestly with your Lord. This is something so devastating about these lines in the prophets of stop with all the nonsense. You really want to understand what it is to relate to me. It's just be a good and moral human being. And in these contexts, the modestly with God connotes also, right, you could read that that God is actually the more powerful force, and you're supposed to be modest in the presence of God, or you can actually read it dialogically, which is that you and God are acting in a state of modesty together. God is modest, why can't you be? So the message of the prophets begins to accentuate not merely the moral clarity, but the accompanying rage, social alienation, and frustration that comes with having a message of moral clarity that's not being heard by the people. This reaches one of its apexes, there are many in the prophetic tradition, with Jeremiah's imprisonment in chapter 20 of Jeremiah on page 3. Pashur, son of Immer, Pashur ben Immer, the priest who was the chief officer of the house of the Lord, heard Jeremiah prophesy these things. Pashur, therefore, had Jeremiah flogged and put in the cell at the upper Benjamin gate at the house of the Lord. Another key element of the prophet is the prophet's suffering. Again, if we want to see Jonah, as we will, as a satire, being swallowed by a giant fish, is a kind of playing out in a kind of mockery of the suffering, social alienation and imprisonment that's almost inevitable whenever a prophet when the people are actually hearing him and frustrated by what he has to say. The next day, Pashur released Jeremiah from the cell. So even though he punishes him first, part of the reason I think we're meant to understand his release is because he's actually not dangerous. He's just annoying. Right, he gets punished because of the frustration that he's promoting to other people, but he's not dangerous enough to be imprisoned in perpetuity. He merely needs to be caged once in a while to calm down. But true to the form, the kind of antisocial elements of who the prophet actually is, the minute he gets released from prison, he says to him, the Lord has named you not Pashur, but Magor Misaviv, which is transliterated here, but one who creates fear all around him. Where it's like the guy has now released you from jail, and now you start yelling at him, right? Instead of Jeremiah re-entering back into the social order, realizing that he can't actually retain these kind of antisocial elements and still constitute living as part of the free society, has no interest in essence in preserving those relationships, actually turns on his captor and attacks him back. He is unendingly hostile to the sources of power in the place in which he's living, who he identifies as being the source of the core problem. And then he goes on reciting let me read it through quickly. For thus said the Lord, I'm going to deliver you and all of your friends over to terror. They will fall by the sword of their enemies while you look on. I will deliver all Judah into the hands of the king of Babylon. He will exile them to Babylon or put them to the sword. One never knows when you read these what the response of the surrounding people actually is, and I suspect it falls into one of two categories. One is anger, which would promote them throwing him into jail, And I would suspect that the second and more common reaction to the prophet is people rolling their eyes. Right? And that's what happens when the insistence on total moral clarity is accompanied by a kind of antipathy to the social order, which makes it almost impossible to hear what the prophet understands to be a completely direct moral message. The obviousness of the moral message is actually in some ways its own undoing. And so when he now goes on this tirade, I imagine in the background, the people rolling their eyes. I will deliver all the wealth, all the riches, and all the prized possessions of the city, and I'll deliver also the treasures of the kings of Judah into the hands of their enemies. They shall seize them as plunder and carry them off to Babylon. As for you, Pashhur, and all who live in your house, you shall go into captivity. You shall come to Babylon. There you shall die, and there you shall be buried, and so shall all your friends to whom you prophesied falsely. You enticed me, O Lord, and I was enticed. You overpowered me, and you prevailed. I have become a constant laughingstock. Everyone jeers at me. This is the tragedy of Jeremiah, is his honesty here, right? The recognition, his honesty of, I'm listening to you, right? The prophet is, in essence, more than anything else, essentially a megaphone. Right, he understands with a direct line the message that God is giving him, and his job is to tell it to other people. But the direct consequence of being a megaphone from God is alienation from other human beings. And he now has a grievance or a complaint against God, which is that I'm listening to you. I'm doing what you're asking me to do, but the consequence of my doing what you're asking me to do is a total alienation from my peers, a mockery, and making of myself a laughingstock. For every time I speak, I have to cry out, Hamas vashod, lawlessness and rapine, for the word of the Lord causes me constant disgrace and contempt. I thought, and I love the internal monologue of the prophet here, of what prophet might do to salvage his own dignity, which comes in verse 9. I have thought, I will not mention him, no more will I speak in his name, but his word was like a raging fire in my heart, shut up in my bones, I could not hold it in, I was helpless. It's unbelievable, right? The internalization of, I know that the more that I speak as a prophet, the more frustration it causes me. I know that the more I insist on the clarity of this moral message, my inability to live in the society grows. I would rather not be mocked, imprisoned, right, with the jeers all around me, and I try to suppress it. But here's the torture or the torment that the prophet experiences, which is that if you have the voice of God echoing in your ears, whether it is literally the voice of God or the figurative voice of God, which is the absolute insistence that the moment in which you're living in is a moment of the total moral clarity between black and white, which I want to suggest is the modern equivalent of living with the voice of God in your head. Jeremiah basically says here in this moment, there was nothing I could do. It burned in me so much that if I was going to wind up, if I was going to stay silent, I was fighting against the force of God and moral clarity in my own head. If I ultimately, and we'll see this becomes echoed in Heschel, the few are guilty but all are responsible, that notion that if I live through this moment without doing what I'm supposed to be doing in this moment, I am complicit in the same social ills that I started to try to correct. Jeremiah is in something very inhuman about Jeremiah here because of the total moral clarity of the position that he's hearing from God. And there's also something incredibly relatably human about the compulsion that he feels as a result of this moral message to not be able to stay silent in this moment. I heard the whispers of the crowd, terror all around. Inform, let us inform against him. All of my supposed friends are waiting for me to stumble. Perhaps he can be entrapped and we can prevail against him and take our vengeance on him. The prophet becomes paranoid. This is, I think, a clear characteristic of the prophets everywhere, is the natural slippery slope to paranoia, right? Because it's not just that people are coming to get me, but they're totally failing to listen to me. And the rising tide that a prophet feels is that it's not merely a small problem that I've identified, but that everyone who fails to correct that problem is complicit in this social order against me. The prophet may initiate, may start from a place of feeling that there's a problem in the society, but that not everyone is responsible for it. But the consequence over time is an accumulating sensibility that is merely the prophet entirely against the rest of the world. And that everybody, it's almost like the room is closing in against him. Classic kind of paranoid tendencies is being played out in verse 10. And what reassures Jeremiah ultimately is what begins in verse 11. But the Lord is with me like a mighty warrior. Therefore, my persecutors shall stumble. They will not prevail, and they will not succeed. They shall be utterly shamed with a humiliation for all time, which will not be forgotten. The only consolation that the prophet ultimately has, increasingly as he distances himself from the social order, becomes paranoid, becomes alien, and becomes punished, the only consolation he has is the one friend he has left, which is God. This is the place in which if we imagine that power for a moral agent can stem either from God, who speaks to the moral agent with moral clarity, or it can come from human beings who trust that person, grant them power, and grant them authority to act in the world in particular ways, the prophet falls entirely in the camp of the former. The more he becomes distant and alien from other human beings, the more not only he trusts the moral message that comes to him from God, the more he needs that relationship with God as the only friend he has left in the world. The prophet is pathetic. You can push me on that later. I want to look at the two satires that I mentioned that I think bring this to full fruition. One is the last chapter of the book of Jonah. The idea of Jonah as satire was introduced to me by Professor Jeremy Dauber of Columbia, and I think he's totally right. I think it's satire in the sense that Jonah kind of takes all of the elements of the prophetic and makes them not just laughable, right, jumping in the water and getting eaten by a fish is, I think, meant to be funny. But not only laughable, but in some ways like a perfect manifestation or a perfect fulfillment of the story of the prophets. For instance, when he actually goes to the people of Nineveh and gets them to repent, they repent immediately. I think that's supposed to be funny. But nobody repents immediately. The prophet is always supposed to be a failure. But the minute that literally, he walks into the city and says, you people should repent because God's coming, and they all repent. And not only do they all repent, but I think the funniest part of the story is that the people put on sackcloth and the animals put on sackcloth. As if to say, like, everybody was like, okay, we got it. Which is a mockery not only of the process by which a prophet makes change, but also a mockery of the people Israel. The people Israel are unable to hear the moral message of God, but even the cows of Nineveh can hear the moral message of God and understand what it is to repent. The other element that I think is meant to be satirical about the story of Jonah, which I think draws into clarity the elements of the prophetic that I'm trying to play out here, is that he's really antisocial, Jonah. He has no relationships in this story that work. He hears the message of what God wants him to do, and he runs away, right? Unlike Jeremiah, who says, I didn't want to do it, but I felt forced to do it, Jonah's first instinct is to actually run away from God. He winds up with an antisocial relationship to the rest of the people on the ship, who are all praying for salvation, and what's Jonah doing while they're praying? Sleeping down in the, right? They, in order to save themselves, they throw the prophet Jonah off into the water, which is the perfect playing out of Jeremiah. This is not just throwing it to jail, it's actually throwing him away. And ultimately, when he actually fulfills his mission, and rarely do prophets fulfill their mission, when he actually goes to the people of Nineveh, tells them to repent, and they repent. And the reason why he's so reluctant to go to the people of Nineveh is because the consequence of getting the Assyrians to repent is the destruction of Jerusalem. Right? He loves the Jewish people, apparently, so much so that he doesn't want to facilitate their destruction. But the consequence of this is that Jonah then decides for the rest of his life to essentially live alone. And the story of Jonah is, at by the end, with this bizarre little piece in chapter 4, through which like 95% of the Jewish people sleep every year, because this is, if it's read at Yom Kippur, by this time it's like Jonah is ideal nap time for me in Yom Kippur. By the end of the story, he's essentially alone, not merely alienated from other human beings, but also alienated from God. So the whole thing displeases Jonah greatly. That is the fact that he brought this message to Assyria and they repented. He prayed to the Lord saying, God, isn't this what I just said when I still in my country? That's why I fled beforehand to Tarshish, for I know that you're compassionate and gracious God, slow to anger, abounding in kindness, renouncing punishment. And he doesn't say what he means, which is meant to come next, which is, therefore, why have you not given the opportunity for the Israelites to repent? Since you allow people to repent, why are you giving that opportunity merely to the Assyrians and not to the Israelites? Please, Lord, take my life, for I would rather die than live. The Lord mocks Jonah in response and says, really? Are you really that deeply aggrieved? Like, this bothers you so much? Now, Jonah left the city and found a place east of the city. He made a booth there and sat under it in the shade until he would see what happened to the city. The Lord God provided a kikayon, I don't know what this is, a ricinus plant, which grew up over Jonah to provide shade for his head and save him from discomfort. Jonah was very happy with the plant. This is, I think, one message of satire here. The joy that comes to the prophet is through this plant. That's it. No human contact throughout the story or even the message that he's been given from God actually gives him any joy, but the plant gives him joy, right? This sitting, right? The ideal image for the prophet is sitting alone away from other human beings in the shade, right? The shade is the thing that turns it over. But the next day at dawn, God provided a worm which attacked the plant so that it withered. And when the sun rose, God provided a sultry east wind. The sun beat down on Jonah's head and he became faint. He begged for death saying, I would rather die than live, which is now the second time he's used this phrase, the first time because of a real moral problem, the second because of his own suffering. Then God said to Jonah, are you so deeply grieved about the plant? So God repeats the same phrase back to Jonah. One second, were you really bothered before, or are you bothered the same way that you're bothered about the plant? I was like, "What? Where are you, Jonah, in this story? Who are you meant to be? Yes, he said, so deeply that I want to die. God is doing some good pedagogy here. Then the Lord said, you cared about the plant which you do not work for, which you did not grow, which appeared overnight and perished overnight. And should I not care about Nineveh, that great city in which there are more than 120,000 people who do not know their right hand from their left, and many animals as well? And the book of Jonah concludes. Jonah fails the Isaiah test here, which is his insistence that... The moral message of the prophet is to be loyal to the moral obligations that are being played out. Jonah has kind of crossed over with his self-regard here to a place of caring in some ways more about himself than what he's supposed to be doing. Right? What God essentially says, I think, with this plant-killing episode is, Jonah, it was never about you. It wasn't about you. You were a mouthpiece or a megaphone for a mission that I was trying to achieve in the world. And actually, you were never even supposed to understand my mission. This is the problem that Jonah doesn't understand at the beginning of the chapter. I wasn't telling you this because you were supposed to understand it. I was telling you to do something because you were the mouthpiece with which this was supposed to be accomplished and achieved. And your insistence that it had to be understood or interpreted through a lens that makes sense to you morally is a total misunderstanding even of the moral clarity of Isaiah and Jeremiah. The fact that they say, just be a good and righteous person, it's not because that's an anthropocentric version of morality. It's because that's what God told them to do. Be a good human being because I told you to be a good human being. And the more that you interpret this and unpack it through the prism of your own individual experience, the more you care about the people than the moral message, you're not actually living up to what a prophet is supposed to be. The whole point of prophecy is that you are a conduit to God's message, and I don't care about you. Whereas that's the real tragedy of Jeremiah, is when Jeremiah says, at least I know that I have a friend in God, is the message that Jonah hears at the end of this, which is, I need you as the prophet to do something, but you're ultimately not really my friend. You're an instrument, right? And the more that you forget about yourself as instrument, the more you lose an understanding of what it is that I set you out to do. The second key satire, I think, though, of what the message of the prophet is supposed to be, at least for Jews and our self-understanding of why the prophet is so problematic, is the manifestation of the prophet as someone who stands so radically outside of our community that he threatens the integrity of the community itself. And this is the Jesus as understood in the New Testament as a biblical prophet. And the Gospel of Matthew is the best site with which to do this because the Gospel of Matthew is the most Jewish of the Gospels. It's most likely to have been authored by a Jew who saw himself as within the prophetic tradition. And you can hear the echoes of the same ideas of the prophets in the story of Jesus in the New Testament. This is probably the most famous story in the New Testament about Jesus' prophecy, which, as you see in verse 12, is entering the temple courts, driving out all those who are buying and selling and overturning the tables of the moneylenders. Or the money changers. Let's just read through it quickly. As they approached Jerusalem and came to Bethpage on the Mount of Olives, Jesus sent two disciples, saying to them, go to the village ahead of you, you'll find a donkey, untie the donkey, and then you walk through on the donkey. I'm just skipping ahead. A large crowd spread their cloaks on the road, while others cut branches from the trees and spread them on the road. The crowds that went before him and those that followed shouted, Hosanna to the Son of David. Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. They essentially say Hallel. This is meant to be around the holidays. When Jesus entered Jerusalem, the whole city was stirred and asked, who is this? The crowd answered, this is Jesus, the prophet from Nazareth in the Galilee. And Jesus' response, therefore, is an act of violence towards a social order, which in return becomes the fulfillment of the Jeremiah story in which he is not merely imprisoned but killed. All right, the prophets are usually not meant to be punished the way that Jesus ultimately does. And the reason I'm using the language of satire is because I think the New Testament is trying to make Jesus not just a prophet, but a prophet who can actually do something. Unlike the rest of the prophets of the biblical tradition, the prophets of the biblical tradition insist on a mission of moral justice and righteousness and ultimately constitute failures. They ultimately sit outside of the system with no sense of continuity between themselves and the people, no family relationships, and ultimately they suffer the consequences of their insistence on a moral message, even if that moral message goes unheeded. What Jesus does to rupture or to shatter that paradigm is to do the same things as the prophets, but to be rewarded by being put into a family structure where he actually has a father and a family. And he also plays out the perfect vision of the prophet who does not suffer for no reason. His suffering becomes tied to the possibility of actual salvation on earth. So the notion of the kingdom of heaven as coming to earth suggests you think that those prophets entirely had to suffer with no consequences for the society, you're wrong. If you do it right, you actually can bring about the kingdom of heaven on earth. So let me just review what the key elements, the core characteristics of the prophetic are. The prophet is a visionary in the fullest sense, believes in the possibility of the transformation of the social order, and believes in the total moral clarity of his message. The prophet is a megaphone for God. There's a divine message, and it's very clear, and his job is merely to broadcast it. The prophet, perhaps as a consequence of that moral message, is completely alienated horizontally and vertically from the society in which he lives, and the prophet goes from stages of frustration to rage in terms of his inability to actually achieve change as a result of not being heard. I want to think of this on, if you think of like an x-axis and a y-axis. I'm not so good at these kinds of things, but if there's an x-axis and a y-axis, and on the x-axis, you have the power that comes to the prophet, either from God at the top or from the people at the bottom. And the y-axis is the line from, and you guys are laughing at me, I see it. And the y-axis, so the x-axis, is power from God and from the people, and the y-axis is from humility to authority, right? Maybe X and Y axis are not the best way to do this, but whatever. All of the prophet's power comes from his relationship with God, which grants him an inordinate amount of authority. However, the absence of any power that comes from people counters and balances that authority with a humility that is forced upon him. I want to suggest that for the rabbinic, it's completely flipped. The nature of rabbinic authority is that it is entirely from the people and not at all from God, which grants you very little authority in the sense of moral clarity, right? You have the humility of not knowing whether the things that you're doing are actually correct, but counterbalances with an authority that's actually granted you by the people. It's an anthropocentric notion of this relationship between humility and clarity, which is a totally different vision. We can play that out a little bit more. I want to look at a few different sources. I gave to you here as source six, Abraham Joshua Heschel. And this is, Heschel, I think, has been for modern Jews the interpreter and promoter of this prophetic idea in translating it into an ideal for what it means to be a morally courageous human being. If you see just a couple of key paragraphs here in the middle of page seven, to a person endowed with prophetic sight, everyone else appears blind. To a person whose ear perceives God's voice, everyone else appears deaf. No one is just. No knowing is strong enough. No trust complete enough. The prophet hates the approximate. He shuns the middle of the road. Man must live on the summit to avoid the abyss. There is nothing to hold except God. Carried away by the challenge, the demand to straighten out man's ways, the prophet is strange, one-sided, an unbearable extremist. I think this is what we see in all of these texts that we saw before. Skip down to the bottom. The prophet disdains those for whom God's presence is comfort and security. To him it is a challenge, an incessant demand. This we heard in Jeremiah. God is compassion, not compromise, justice, though not inclemency. The prophet's predictions can always be proved wrong by a change in man's conduct, but never the certainty that God is full of compassion. The prophet's word is a scream in the night while the world is at ease and asleep. The prophet feels the blast of heaven, and so on and so forth, even the last two paragraphs. The words the prophet utters are not offered as souvenirs. His speech to the people is not a reminiscence, a report, hearsay. The prophet not only conveys, he reveals. He almost does unto others what God does unto him. In speaking, the prophet reveals God. There's much more that can be played out of Heschel here, but what Heschel has done is distilled all these key elements that we see in the prophetic tradition and translates it into what is ultimately, I think for Heschel, a vision of what it means to be a moral human being. But what I want to suggest is actually an incredibly alienating way to be a human being, not only for the individual who's seeking to be the prophet, but for the society which struggles to hear it. What I want to do next, though, is to look a little bit at what I call the rabbinic critique of the prophet, which is, I want to say it's in the hatred of the clarity of the divine message, but at least I'll cushion that a little bit and say it's a skepticism or perhaps a fear about the divine message. Right? We are, by definition, scared or fearful of individuals who come along claiming to speak very clearly in the name of God. Rabbis are not objecting to the idea that a person should be a good and righteous human being, but they do object to the idea that certain people are endowed with God's voice in their ear. I think they're terrified by that idea, and I think partly they're terrified by that idea, this is one limited historical argument, because of Jesus. Because the idea that someone would come along and translate the language of prophecy to become God himself indicates to the rabbis the very problematic of the prophet themselves. The more that you allow for the possibility that a person is the mouth of God or has the ear in which God is speaking, the more you set yourself on a course for a person to translate themselves as the incarnation of God in God's self. So we're going to hear in a couple of these rabbinic texts, the skepticism, or the anxiety at least, about what the prophetic actually conveys, and the seeking for a different mode of morally courageous leadership that doesn't involve either the moral clarity of the prophet himself or the social alienation that comes from that moral clarity. So for instance, on the bottom of page 9, Talmud Sota 48b, when you see by the end of the tractate of Sota, the tractate of Sota deals with the suspected adulteress. I think I teach a text from Sota pretty much every year. I think it's the best tractate, precisely because of the reason that we're going to see here. The tractate Sota deals with this incredibly problematic biblical text around the suspected adulteress, which conveys, the whole notion of the ritual of the suspected adulteress conveys that God's presence is in our midst. As a result, by the time you get to the end of the tractate, the rabbis are so anxious about the idea that of God's presence being in our midst, and so convinced that we need an anthropocentric means of establishing justice and righteousness, and no longer a divine-centered means of doing this, that the end of the tractate becomes this extended meditation on the transition from God's authority to human authority. And here's a good example of it. We'll start with the second paragraph here. Come in here. When the first temple was destroyed, the cities with pasture land were abolished. Not sure exactly what that means. The Urim and Tumim, that is the kind of like like R2-D2 system of channeling divine message through flashing lights and holy stones that was in the Holy Temple, that ceased. There was no longer a king from the house of David. And if anyone incites you to quote the verse, the governor said unto them, they should not eat of the most holy things until there stood up a priest with these Urim v'Tumim. You should reply to him, it is only a phrase for the very remote future, as when another person says to another person, until the dead revive and the Messiah, son of David, comes. Just want to unpack something really interesting here, which is when people say, you know, when what the rabbis are basically saying is when a person talks about the Messianic age, you should just imagine, understand that rhetorically. That is far off in the future. In other words, what they say is, sometimes people use the language of like when Messiah comes to suggest that Messiah is coming. And what they're saying here is you use the language of when Messiah comes to convey something you don't really believe in. Like, that's far off in the future. If a person comes along and tells you that they are a direct conduit to the message of God, tell them, we don't have that anymore. That's not ours. I'll skip down to the next paragraph, because then the rabbis start talking about what happens at the demise of the prophets, and where does the authority to lead ultimately go? And we know that in the rabbis' self-understanding, the transition of authority moves from the prophets to the rabbis themselves. However, they have to navigate to what extent are the rabbis actually a continuation of the mouthpiece of God or something else entirely. The first stage in this process in the transition of this moral authority is as follows. On one occasion, some rabbis were sitting in the upper chamber of Guria's house in Jericho. A bat kol, a divine voice, was granted to them from heaven, which announced, there is in your midst one man who is deserving that the holy presence should alight upon him, but his generation is unworthy of it. They all knew who it was, right? The voice comes out from heaven and says, one of you is actually has a direct relationship with God, but there's something wrong in this generation, which means he's incapable of accessing it. The first stage in the transition from the prophetic to the rabbinic is the understanding of the possibility of divine inspiration in human beings, but the anxiety that we not allow people to claim that because of the problems in our society. In this case, however, at the first generation, everybody knows who it is. I like the image of this, like everyone's sitting around, a divine voice comes out, and everyone like looks to one guy. And the one guy they're looking at, of course, is Hillel the elder. And when he died, they lamented over him, alas, the pious man, the humble man, the disciple of Ezra. On another occasion, they were sitting in an upper chamber in Yavne. A bat kol, a divine voice, was granted them from heaven, which announced, there is in your midst one man who is deserving that the Shekhinah should alight upon him, but his generation is unworthy of it. This happens again. Once again, they all turn and look at Shmuel the little, Shmuel HaKatan, and when he died, they lamented over him, alas, the humble man, and so on and so forth. At the time of his death, they give an extended eulogy as well. Finally, they also wish to lament over Rabbi Yehuda ben Baba, alas, the pious man, the humble man, which we can hear has become their shorthand for how they talk about the people who really have divine authority. Like, we did it the first time, and then when we did it the second time, we were corroborating, we think that guy was the guy. But they wouldn't even do it in the time of Yehuda ben Baba, because the times were disturbed, that is, a period of persecution, and they could not lament publicly over those who had been slain by the government. Now, what's essentially rising here is the tendency or the willingness to interpret the political social orders of the times in which we're in as not merely in tension with God's moral clarity, but actually overtaking the desire to hear God's moral clarity. Right? In the time of Jeremiah, yeah, Jeremiah is persecuted by the people of Israel, but he insists on his moral message at the cost of his human relationships. And as we're seeing with the shift in time, the rabbis are actually prioritizing human relationships over the desire to hear the clarity of God's moral message. Does that make sense? You follow that? With the willingness to basically allow that, you know what, I know that it's possible that that person is a continuation of the prophets, but I don't want to play with that game because it's dangerous, is the perfect reversal from the language of Jeremiah, in which I own God's moral message, and I endure and I suffer the consequences of God's moral message at the hands of other human beings. The skepticism rises in the rabbis about this kind of moral clarity in the next text as follows, also in the Talmud. Rabbi Abdimi on page 11, Rabbi Abdimi from Haifa, I think it's page 11. Rabbi Abdimi from Haifa said, since the day the temple was destroyed, prophecy was taken from the prophets and given to the wise. Right? So this suggests, similar to the first rabbinic text, that the transition didn't go, it's not that God's voice disappeared, it's that it moved from the prophets to the sages. It's a little bit of a self-serving text by the rabbis here, and they become aware of it, and they criticize it. They ask the question, so you mean that prophecy never really went away, right? Is then a wise man not a prophet? Like, why the semantics distinction? If you're saying that the issue is prophecy, then whether it's actually to a prophet or to a wise man isn't, like, split the difference. They're both prophets. What he meant was, although it has been taken from the prophets, it has not been taken by the wise. Skip down another to Abaye's comment three lines later. Abaye said, the proof that prophecy has not been taken from the wise is that a great man makes a statement, and the same is then reported in the name of another great man. What's the proof of prophecy? That a person can say something wise, and someone else can come up with the same tradition, right? And it's quoted in someone else's name. And the rabbis realize that the attempt to make their own rabbinic culture sound prophetic is actually silly, which is the critique that comes as follows. Said Rava, what is there strange in this? Perhaps both were born under the same star, which is to say, why is that not a coincidence? The fact that two people come up with something wise to say is not proof of prophecy. It can also be proof of the obviousness of something that someone is saying, or it can also be the proof of a coincidence. And they go on with this as well. But then they finally come to, if you look at the beginning of the second paragraph, Rabbi Yochanan said, now remember, Rabbi Avdimi at the beginning of the first paragraph said, prophecy was taken from the prophets and given to the wise. And then we tried to unpack whether it's actually possible for us to understand the rabbis as the continuation of the prophets, or whether the fact that the rabbis operate with a totally different notion of authority suggests that it's no longer the clarity of the divine message, but something else entirely that's happening. And so by the time you get to Rabbi Yochanan's position, Rabbi Yochanan says as follows, since the temple was destroyed, prophecy has been taken from prophets and given to fools and children. This is actually a devastating kind of conclusion for the rabbis of this idea of self-empowerment through a moral message. You know who's a prophet? Fools and children, right? People who can actually see, and why fools and children? Because I don't really care at this point about the notion of prophecy has to do with moral clarity. Fools and children are the people in a social order who see things for what they are without interest in the kind of social structures that are created that normalize and normativize those societies. Children see things that adults do as funny because adults have been socialized into systems that make those things seem normal. Fools stand outside a society, according to the way this text understood, and I think they're right, with a certain type of clarity that makes them actually socially alien. Right? So both fools and children are socially alien from the structures that are created by human society. I want to look at one last rabbinic text, and then I want to offer a vision that I think the rabbis offer of what a rabbinic, morally courageous individual looks like. The last text I want to look at here as part of the critique is from Song of Songs, Rabbah. Rabbi Meir said on page 12, when Israel stood before Mount Sinai to receive the Torah, the Holy Blessed One said to them, shall I give you the Torah? Bring me good assurances, sureties, that you will actually keep it, and then I will give it to you. God says, why would I give you my Torah? I don't trust you people. I don't know what you're going to do with it. This is valuable to me. Show me, prove to me with a surety, right, collateral, that there's something that you have that you're willing to put as the stakes, the skin in the game, to receive the Torah. They replied, Master of the Universe, our ancestors will be our guarantors. Right? This is a classic zchut avot, rely on our ancestors and give it to us. They were like a man who went to borrow from the king and to whom the king said, bring me a surety, I will lend you. He went and brought him a surety, whereupon the king said, your surety himself requires a surety. He went to him and brought a second surety. The king said to him, your surety requires a surety. When he brought him a third surety, he said to him, know that for the sake of this man, I will lend you. So when Israel stood ready to receive the Torah, he said to them, I will give you my Torah, but bring me good sureties that you will keep it, and then I will give it to you. They said, our ancestors are our sureties. God said to them, I have faults to find in your ancestors. Right? This is George Costanza's father. I got problems with you people. Right? Don't tell me about what your ancestors did as the legacy that you give, and he goes through the grievances. They then says as follows, they said four lines from the bottom. They then said, sovereign of the universe, our prophets will be our sureties. Right? Let us use the legacy of our prophets who spoke with total moral clarity. And God says, I got problems with you people too. Finally, God, they say to him, our children shall be our sureties. To which God replied, these are good sureties. If you're willing to put the continuity of your children as the stakes by which you receive the Torah, that I'm willing to trust. Now consider the difference, conceptually, between the rabbinic move about the relationship of parents to children to the prophetic move. The prophet responds to God's message by becoming a fanatical, devoted adherent to God's message. The rabbinic move in response to God's message says our primary responsibility is to develop systems in which to create continuity between what we do and what our children do, right? Even if the cost of that is the clarity of the moral message as it exists in the present. The text concludes, and it's a magnificent text, the text concludes by saying, therefore it is a man's duty to introduce his son to the study of Torah and to give him a good grounding in order that he may live long in the world. The moral obligation that comes from the relationship between parents and children is the teaching of Torah, which is the ultimate rabbinic act. The prophetic move is one of anger, indignancy, righteous indignation against a society which has little regard for the culture of parents and children, much less friends. The rabbinic critique of the prophetic is, you may have total moral clarity, but how do I know that the moral clarity you create in this particular generation will have any continuity for years to come? Rabbis distrust the prophets both because they distrust the idea that someone is walking around with the message of God in their ears, but they also distrust the prophets because the message of the prophets is one that has no continuity. The rabbis are willing to trade the moral clarity of the prophets for the continuity of their children. So what's a vision then, and with this I'll conclude and open up to some questions. What's a vision then, if for the rabbis, of what a morally courageous individual in the rabbinic model looks like? And for the rabbis, I think it's Abraham, but not just Abraham, but a rabbinic Abraham. This is important. It's not just Abraham of the Bible, but it's who they are going to make Abraham into being. And I'll just use one example, which is Genesis Rabbah 39:6, a midrash about Abraham. And this is look on page 14 in the third sentence here. When Abraham our father stood to plead for mercy for the Sodomites, what is written there? That be far from you to do after this manner. Rabbi Acha explained this, you have sworn not to bring a deluge upon the world. Would you evade your own oath? You want to bring destruction on the world, but you promised after the flood that you wouldn't do that again. Not a deluge of water will you bring, but a deluge of fire. Then you have not been true to your oath. I'm going to hold God accountable.
A little too fast. We can't find where you are in the text here.
Text 12.
Text 12, Genesis Rabbah 39:6. Then you have been after truth. Oh, I have page numbers. I don't know why that is. Rabbi Levi commented, shall not the judge of the earth do justly? And here's the key line here. If you desire the world to endure, there can be no absolute justice. Well, if you desire absolute justice, the world cannot endure. What Abraham does here is educate God about the morality of the world. God, you can't have both. What you think you're going to do is bring about absolute justice by destroying the people of Sodom. But the absolute justice that you're bringing to the world cannot make the possibility of the world endure. The rabbis, this is the ultimate rebuke to the prophetic image. You read Micha and you say, yeah, it's easy. Just bring about justice and righteousness. And what the rabbis come to do is to say, that vision of justice and righteousness, which seems so incredibly easy in the book of Micha, actually in some ways comes at the cost of the world. Because God's vision of justice and righteousness is almost a standard by which humans cannot live. Yet you would hold the cord by both ends, desiring both the world and absolute justice. Avram says to God, according to the rabbis, unless you forget a little bit, the world cannot endure. This is kind of staggering. What Abraham has to remind God is that what looked like a basic moral insistence on do good and be righteous, that translates into a human righteous indignation and frustration about why the fulfillment of good in the world is not possible, Abraham educates, or at least reminds God, that that vision of justice and righteousness that seems so clear and obvious cannot coexist with the world perpetuating as it is. That's just not who human beings are. What I tried to do is to paint a picture of the prophet as a morally courageous character, right? By all the fulfillments of the characteristics that I aimed at the beginning, the prophet is a morally courageous character. The prophet is also socially alien. The prophet speaks with a very clear moral clarity at the cost of his own individual self. And the prophet is a visionary with kind of black and white categories about what the world should look like. There is something, I think, for the modern that is incredibly appealing about the language of the prophet, and I've actually seen it resurface in some rabbinic leadership in America today of the retrieval of the prophetic voice. What do we need to do? We need to get angry like the prophets. I think partly that comes from it comes historically from the juxtaposition of Heschel's idea of the prophet together with Heschel's participation in the civil rights movement, which felt in very serious ways like a morally clear issue without gray areas that enabled people to grasp on to the clear justice and righteous messages of the prophets. But I do fear for it. I fear that in this insistence for a moral order, the prophet emerges as a morally courageous actor, but oftentimes at the cost of self and sometimes at the cost of the issue. Prophet sows the seeds of his own demise, right? The prophet's hard to listen to. The prophet's advocacy comes oftentimes at the cost of the issue of the message and with no continuity. The rabbis, in response, resist both the idea of the total moral clarity of any particular message of representing God, but they also fear that the insistence on that moral clarity comes not only at the cost of the individual, but actually at the cost of the world. The world, according to the rabbis, as sad and devastating as this is, cannot coexist with perfect justice and righteousness. And therefore, the definition of a rabbinic effort towards moral courage is the iterative, slow continuity process as opposed to the radical transition of the prophets. Last word. I think we're the inheritors of both, even if we are primarily the people of the rabbis. I'd say, me personally, I share the deep skepticism of the prophetic tradition. I think it actually sets us up for failure, not just as individuals who see ourselves as prophetic actors, but also as communities and societies that insist on the clarity of this moral message. And while I understand the longing for the prophetic mode as a means for people to relate to problems that they see and a sense of indignation like Jeremiah, the fire burning in him, the insistence that this problem is not something he can set to the side and not something he can simply reject, but a moral message that's demanding of him to act in the world. I do wonder whether part of what the rabbis are reminding us is that in order for the world to exist, that has to be fought and sometimes suppressed. And that until this messianic imagination, right, that the rabbis imagined, that one day we will be able to hear the message of God in the world, I think the rabbis' message, that the insistence on God's moral clarity is actually more dangerous than the alternative. Thank you. Yes. The rabbis are the ones who interpret that phrase, whatever they tell you, you should listen to, as being rabbis. But I hope the question was, doesn't the Torah itself tell us whatever they tell you to do, you should do? which is in reference to leaders who are not yet rabbis, right? Rabbis are a historically located phenomenon. The rabbis are the ones who interpret that verse, all that they tell you to do, you should do, in reference to themselves. So there's no question that for the rabbis on the, I forget whether it's the Y or X axis, they're very conscious of the need to source human authority and that they need to make a claim on human authority in order to stabilize their ability to do something morally powerful in the world. But I think what I think we see in these texts is that they're incredibly cautious to not translate that moral authority to be divine authority. That they know that they're playing in divine territory, but they're not willing to let it carry its way into prophecy. Yes? Okay, so the question is it necessarily a characteristic of the prophet to have to tell other people what they're doing is wrong, as opposed to simply acting in a certain way and becoming an exemplar that changes the actions of others? My instinct is actually yes. I think it's a critical component of how I understand the prophets in this tradition to be actually advocates against others. There's a kind of oppositional stance that the prophet means to exemplify, who's not merely supposed to be an exemplar of how a person acts in the world, but rather an insistent to others that that person changes. I think actually what you're describing to me is actually the rabbinic. What Abraham becomes to the rabbis is a person who goes through the world trying to get God to act differently and trying to get human beings to act differently through imitating and mirroring his actions. But that the difference precisely between the prophetic and the rabbinic is that the prophet can't stop with simply acting well. The prophet sees a problem in a society and feels a profound urgency to push and transform that society. And it's precisely because of that, the toxicity of that encounter, that the prophet, on one hand, emerges as a morally clear voice, on the other hand, emerges as a socially alien human being. Yeah, Jerry.
They were human actors, and what they did is take the God's moral clarity and put it through human agencies to try to articulate it. And maybe that attempt to do that translation created the frustration and the rage that we see in the prophets. And what you really don't have maybe a dichotomy between the prophets and the rabbinics, because the prophets had something the rabbinics don't. The rabbinics have the text. But the prophets had something burning within them that they had to translate into human terms and come to, and make some kind of statement, and they were just having trouble. There was trouble doing that in that interpretation. Maybe it's closer than you're thinking.
I could think about it more. Look, I'm offering a heuristic reading. It's certainly possible, and the comment is a pushback of the prophetic and the rabbinic are closer on the theory that the prophet is not really a megaphone, but an interpreter of God's message, and that the rabbis through their text are also essentially interpreters of God's message, and that they're closer together than I'm imagining. I'm not sure. I actually think both intellectually as a heuristic, the model of presenting two different scenarios helps us think about what are the unique qualities of each. If the consequence is, you know, thesis, antithesis, and you're trying to provide synthesis, I can probably live with that. But I think there's a greater severity to what the rabbis are doing in resisting and pushing against the message of the prophets than I think you're giving credit for. I think the rabbis actually are troubled deeply by the problematics of the prophet, and that's partly what makes me inclined to believe that there's something radically different with what the prophet is doing than what the rabbi is doing.
Yeah, I love the presentation, and I share your critique of the prophetic and your intuitive sympathy with the rabbinic. That said, if you apply this lecture to the two successors of progressive North American Judaism in the last 30 years, women are equal. so sorry, but our hands are tied. Our hands are tied. We can't help you. There was a prophetic voice that made it okay to be gay, and the same obtains equal rights for women. So I think prophetic has a place and has actually been more effective in shaping Judaism than most of us who live in America.
So do people hear the question in the back? No? The comment, and I'm going to repeat it and not say it as eloquently as you did, is that if you accept the theory of this lecture, you undermine essentially the two great accomplishments that progressive Jews have been most proud of, which is the advancement of women and the acceptance of gays. And that had we been more embracing of the rabbinic model, we would have said, I hear you, but my hands are tied, whereas the prophetic model is the one that achieves change. First of all, I would want to probe that a little bit more. I think that actually social change is achieved actually through a hybrid of the rabbinic and prophetic, even though I don't think they're the same. I think the prophetic voices sometimes can make clear a social injustice that requires the intervention of the rabbinic. But the more important piece is, the second lecture to this should be, how do we not allow rabbinic to be my hands are tied? Or it's, you have actually said rabbinic authority by its very nature assumes that one's hands are tied. But actually the rabbis see themselves as transformative social change agents. That's why they imagine Abraham as a rabbi. Because what they imagine of Abraham is a person who can actually go around, educate God, and bring about a sense of justice and righteousness, not through the righteous indignation of the prophet, but through the negotiated, rational, calculated process that only the rabbi can do. And in that respect, the fact that they make Abraham more rabbinic than they make him prophetic signals to them that they're trying to say something not just about who Abraham is, but what they want rabbis to be. And I guess that my pushback is, as a chavruta, where have been the efforts that have actually advanced these social issues, that have actually relied heavily on the prophetic voice, and where has actually the rabbinic voice been more effective in bringing about a larger mass of the people? Yes? Good. So is it the part of the, maybe even the effectiveness, is the prophetic is threatening, do this or else, future-oriented, as opposed to working on the cause for its own sake. Fair? The interesting piece to me is that actually both of these are future-oriented, but one of them has much more confidence in the future. Right? The notion that, because the core premise of the rabbinic mode is the belief that our children are our sureties, is a way of saying I'm also future-oriented, and I know I'm going to have children and grandchildren in the future, and maybe it won't be the ideal society that the prophet is demanding of me in the future, but I also feel a sense of security and stability in imagining that future. I mean, this is... I have to think about this more, but I wonder sometimes with all the panic about the Jewish future, all of that to me reads as the prophetic instinct that it's his own self-fulfilling prophecy. The more anxious we are and paranoid about what we won't be in the future, the more we sound like prophets who actually arrest the natural processes of growth and continuity in children. And the rabbinic mode is both about the repair of the present, but it's also just, it's about a calm about the existence of a future in spite of what feel like profoundly difficult conditions. You know, this is why, in part, the major adaptation of the rabbis was the willingness to actually live in history as opposed to being paralyzed by it. Had the rabbis, in their early iterations, accepted the notions of the prophets, Judaism dies. Because its failure to do what it's supposed to do, its rupture of the core civilization, the land of Israel, into the temple, there's no continuity, it's impossible. The rabbinic willingness, the rabbinic revolution is the willingness to imagine a future even if it's imperfect.
Yes? Where do false prophets fit into this, and why is it that so often they're not nearly as despised by the people as the true prophets?
So where do false prophets fit in here, and why are they not nearly as despised by the people as true prophets? So first of all, part of the psychological resistance by Jews to hear prophets and to think of them primarily as being false prophets unless proven otherwise, which becomes part of kind of the rabbinic understanding, is precisely this problem. If a prophet is playing in the world of total moral clarity as the Torah, as they understand God speaking in their ears, the rabbis understand that a true prophet is actually is incredibly dangerous, and that a false prophet is even more dangerous, because if he can actually hold the sway of the people with the belief that he's actually speaking with God's voice, then people will fall behind him. I think I would flip the question a little bit. I think prophets are, in essence, always compelling to people who are looking for transformative solutions to problems, and always dangerous. So the reason why false prophets are compelling is they provide total moral clarity and the ability to solve problems in non-iterative, non-hands-tied types of ways. And that's precisely the reason why they're effective, which is also precisely the reason why they're dangerous and why the societies almost inevitably will turn on them the way that Jeremiah did and actually come to punish them. Take a couple more. Yes, sir.
So if I heard on your list of requirements to be a prophet, you know, optimism, risk, looking outside yourself, alienated, clarity, frustration, rage, and I look in the modern era, I come up with the Psalm of Ben Laden. Yeah. So I'm saying there's something missing here.
So let me separate a couple of things. First of all, what I said at the outset is that moral courage combines optimism, risk, and the belief in a larger goal with which we're working, and that's what constitutes moral courage. I'm sorry to tell you, but those characteristics and that effort towards moral courage can be channeled by causes that we consider fundamentally immoral, right? That's possible. Person takes risk on the core of a belief of something significant that they believe needs to be transformative, with the possibility that if they do something, whatever it is that they do is going to result in change. Moral courage, and we know this, can actually be channeled towards things that are moral, or if we disagree with the core premises of the objectives, then we'll call it immoral courage. And yes, it's absolutely also true that these characteristics that we call rabbinic and the characteristics that we call prophetic are not unique to our tradition. They can be channeled by others, and they can be translated into ideas and ideologies that are problematic. But here's the thing, right? The minute that you start talking about justice and righteousness, as we're doing here, you're playing with fire. Because the inability to understand the categories fully, the minute you're talking about what it means to be a truly good human being, to play in the world of moral discourse in the world, it's not a safe conversation. Because either if you don't understand it fully, or you take those premises and then add an element of effectiveness to a slightly misdirected vision of justice and righteousness, you're attaching passion to causes that actually have transformative ability in the world. Okay. Right, that's what it is to actually be a moral actor in the world, is precisely because you know that people are going to use your mechanisms of social change towards causes to which you don't believe. And that's partly what creates the urgency for profound moral courage in the world, is precisely because other people are fighting these fights on the opposite side of these causes. Last one.
Given your read of prophet versus rabbinic tradition, why do you think the rabbis canonized so many prophetic
So the question is, if given my read on the prophetic versus the rabbinic, and if the rabbis are the canonizers, why do they canonize so much of the prophetic tradition? I don't know. Partly, you know, one cynical read is to say that they canonize the prophetic tradition because it signals a moment in Jewish history that is over, and that they are, and in which they are kind of signaling, this was a moment in Jewish history, here are its problems. And this is what comes as a result. I think the whole question of canonization is an interesting conversation as well. It could simply be kind of chronicling a moment in Jewish history. It also could have a moral message of this was the era of the prophets and this is why it failed. I don't think at the end of the day one has to understand the rabbinic critique of the prophets to say it's impossible to once again retrieve the possibility of the prophetic. right? The rabbis don't hate the prophets, they are fearful and skeptical of what happens if we rehabilitate and resuscitate the culture of prophecy in an era that's not ready for it. So it just becomes a question of do the rabbis imagine that one day we're going to return to the messianic age in which the prophets are going to come back, or are they positioning us for a world in which the prophetic is no longer possible? Thank you.